Good morning. I'm Marcia Gregory. Welcome to our online service of the Swiss Elm Park Primitive Methodist Church. It is our prayer that you are blessed by what you hear today.
Then David spoke to the men who stood by him, saying, "What shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is the uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" And the people answered him in this manner, So shall it be done for the man who kills him." Now Eliab, his oldest brother, heard when he spoke to the men, and Eliab's anger was aroused against David. And he said, "Why did you come down here? And with whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your pride and the insolence of your heart, for you have come down to see the battle." And David said, "What have I done now? Is there not a cause?" Then he turned from him toward another and said the same thing. And these people answered him as the first ones did. Now when the words which David spoke were heard, they reported them to Saul, and he sent for him. Then David said to Saul, "Let no man's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." And Saul said to David, "You are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are a youth, and he a man of war from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep his father's sheep, and when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went out after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth. And when it arose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck and killed it. Your servant has killed both lion and bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God." Moreover, David said, "The Lord, who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." And Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you."
Thank you, Nana, for reading today. Keep in mind, if you would like to read, just put your name on that list back there, and we'll certainly put you in the rotation. Please pray with me. Gracious Father, we give you honor and we give you glory for this opportunity that we have to have your word before us. And we pray, Lord, that as we hear and understand, that it would not just be before us, but it would be part of us. The basis, Lord, for everything that we would do and everything that we would say would come from the truth of your word. And we ask all this in the name of Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Well, this morning, you see, we have one word before you. And what word is that? Battles. And when we think of this weekend and everything that's part of the Memorial Day holiday, I hope it's something that we never forget. Because we live in a day in which sometimes we're quick and trying to more than ever to remove history and cancel history and act as though it did not happen. There are many things in Scripture that we read about that are very difficult to read and very difficult to understand. And when we have these things played out in our mind, we think, and they're in the Bible for what purpose? It should not be there. God is a God of love and hope and daisies and, you know, meadows and brooks flowing through, and you go and stream and play, and battles and carnage. Tomorrow, Krista, the girls, myself, and their friend Maddie will be taking part in the Memorial Day service at the Buena Vista Volunteer Fire Hall. And in preparation for that service, one of the comments was, it's getting harder sometimes to even put these together because of a willingness of people. And isn't it sad what happens when we just have no interest anymore and sometimes we just want to forget about these things? Jesus told us, look, until I come again, always remember I died. Always remember the price that was paid for your redemption and never forget it. And until I come, what does he say? Celebrate. Because as you do, you proclaim my death until I come. And so this morning, for a few moments, and we think of that one word, battles. Battles. And we think of the battles that have been fought over the history of our nation. And we think, according to the Census Bureau, they're saying now that over 1 million servicemen and women have been taken in battles. Think about that. And so this morning we're going to take a look at a battle that came from the passage today that Nana read for us. And it's a very familiar battle, okay? But before we go there, I'd like for you to consider, well, Krista, you might have to help me here. I'd like for you to consider, first of all, what does it mean when we say battle, okay? The battle simply is, sometimes we draw a blank, and then sometimes it comes right up, and we're going to find it here. So the battle, as the slide comes up, it, we'll find out, first of all, is a sustained fight, okay? Not just tea, not just a conversation, but the battle is a sustained fight between large, organized, armed forces. Think about that. When you think about battles and you think about all the things that go on, and in our world today, when you consider battles, well, I guess we got the food truck, and then we got a sustained fight between large, organized armed forces. And we think about today, over 1 million servicemen and women in our country alone have lost their lives in battle. Battle's very serious. But we think also battle is something else as well. It's a fight or struggle to achieve or resist something, because how many of us have battles in our life each day? We might not be standing up and be armed with in a military concept, but in our minds, we struggle. And we have difficulties at times to just achieve something. And then on the other side, to resist something. So we're going to think about battles for a few minutes this morning. And one of the battles we want to consider is the battle between David and Goliath. Now, in fairness to the definition that we had put up, were the forces here in this battle between David and Goliath, were they armed? Yeah. The armies. The army of God and the Philistines. They had weapons. I don't think they had surface-to-air missiles. I don't think they had the weaponry that we know of today. But they had weapons. And so we think of David and Goliath, we think basically, what, of just two individuals. But Goliath was so intimidating and so overwhelming that we forget about that there was an army that accompanied him. Just as well as there was an army that was there representing the kingdom of God before David delivered, according to VeggieTales, pizza, okay, and cheese to his brothers. But what do you know about David for a minute? Let's just think about David as we think about the players here. Who was David at this stage of his life? David was what? He was a shepherd. He was one of how many sons of Jesse? was 8 in the food chain, okay, think about all the hand-me-downs he had. What was left on the plate before it got to him? And so David, in response to his dad's decree, is, well, I guess to make it relevant and current, he was delivering, you know, being an Uber Eats driver and taking stuff over to his brothers. And here in the midst of these things, King Saul and his army, they were in the midst of battle against the Philistines. Now, what can you tell me about Goliath? Goliath had a big slingshot? Goliath was a big guy. What else can you tell me? I remember one time, Jan, I don't know if you were at Trinity when this happened or not, but I was doing an assembly for the elementary and wanted to convey to them the enormous size of Goliath. So I didn't have nothing that I could take that wouldn't be hanging out of the car, so I took our pool skimmer pole and I collapsed it. And then I got there and I telescoped it out. And I think I may have left the net on the front to simulate his head. And I stood there and had this 9-foot pole with this skimmer net on the top. And I still can see these kids standing there like... I remember years back when my brother Donnie, he had tickets to the Pitt Panthers when they used to play, remember this one, at the Field House? Before the Peterson Event Center was built. And that was in the day when they had to pay you to go to the games. I mean, they didn't win. And I remember, you know, we'd go to those games. We'd park somewhere in South Oakland and walk 5 miles up Cardiac Hill. And by the time you got there, you know, you sat there and you perspired through the first half before you even got back to your senses. But anyway, I remember one time we were down close to the, walking by the court, and they were warming up. And those guys don't look that big. But man, standing next to them, holy cow. I remember one time I just got onto the people mover at the airport, you know, where they take you from the land side to the air side. And I got there just as the doors were closing, and I stood up against the wall. Well, one other guy got there right after me, and the door shut, and he stood beside me, and I looked up at him, and he was like this to me. And you know who it was? And he doesn't look big on TV. Bill Cowher. And he had just come back from the combine out in Indianapolis, and we were talking a little bit on the people mover, but you see him on the field when those players would come to him, he doesn't look like a big guy. And then he's standing next to me, and I'm like, oh, could you imagine somebody 9 foot tall? This was Goliath. And so the Philistines, the army, they're basically resting on the fact that Goliath has said to the army of God, bring me your best shot. You know, I just thought of a song for David. Hit me with your best shot. Fire away. We're going to have to do that sometime. You see, David was filled with a lot of faith. Based on the passage of Scripture, here's what God's done, King Saul. The lion, the bear, you name it. Here's what he's done. But you know what just lit David off? God's name was being blasphemed. It bothered him. And to stand there and this guy watching all these men in their battle preparation, standing there shaking in their boots because this 9-foot giant comes out and says, hit me with your best shot. He didn't know a slingshot was going to come at him. But he's basically stood out there and says, I'm the guy. And so, yeah, Joyce, the slingshot came out. And David got him. To add insult to injury, he took Goliath's sword, and what did he do with it? Carved the Christmas turkey? No. He cut off his head. And what happened to the Philistines? Did they now come charge the army of God? No, they ran. They ran for the woods screaming and crying, and they left. David was steamed when this whole thing was going down. And what was going on, as Nana simply read in 1 Samuel chapter 17, David said, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine who is doing what? Defying the armies of the living God." Goliath was basically taunting God and saying, "Are you better than me? Prove it." And all the representatives of the kingdom of God stood there in terror and thought, "What could we do?" Now here comes your little brother. "Get out of here. Yeah. We got this." But David was infuriated. And what was Goliath doing? He was challenging God's people to stand up and demonstrate that their God was more powerful than him. "I dare you." And the army stood back and left this go on. And even King Saul was perplexed. "What are we going to do?" Wouldn't it be so simple if battles were just carried out by two people? Winner take all. Well, guess what? That was the plan here today. Winner take all. But think about that for a moment. The fact that Goliath was taunting God and God's people and saying, "If you have more than I do, stand up and show me. If not, sit down and shut up." And what was God's army doing at that point? Tell me today where that's not still happening. Tell me today where we as the church in many ways are standing there almost like the armies there looking at the Philistines and saying, "What are we going to do? Look at this." And every day there's another giant looking at us and defying and taunting God and saying, "Are you stronger than me? If you are, stand up. If not, sit down and be quiet." And guess what? Many times we do. Challenge the people to stand up. And the only one who came to stand was this little boy, this shepherd, who said, "The faithfulness of God has protected me and delivered me in the midst of these wild animals, and he can do the same for me today." What drove David was that faith and the fact that God's name was being blasphemed. I can't help but read that story again and again and again and think how many times I was standing in the army of God and how many times would I have had the courage of David, or maybe was I on the other side with the Philistines saying, "Yeah, yeah, yeah," and trying to play both sides. But the bottom line is the name of Almighty God, his power, his purpose, his plan was being called out by this 9-foot giant who says, "Hit me with your best shot because I don't think you can take me." And nobody was doing anything about it. Do you believe this today? That God is able to defeat any of the giants that are in our life? Remember this from Wednesday night? Jan, you peeled another layer off the onion. We talked about it on Friday as well, Ron. Believing is easy when nothing's going wrong. Beth, I'm sure believing is easy when you're cancer-free. 15 years ago, how hard was that? I don't know. But I make the statement, it's easy to believe when there's no problems. It's easy to believe when there's no Goliath in our life. It's easy to believe when everything is just wonderful. But the first time we stand and we look at this thing, do we really believe that God is able to defeat the giants in our life? Are we sitting there? Are we quiet? And hoping something can happen because right now we don't know. Our leader, King Saul, he doesn't know what to do. He's not going to get involved. These valiant men who've been trained for warfare, they're standing shaking in their boots. What are we going to do? And here comes the little guy that says, my God is able to defeat any giant in my life and in your life. His name will not be dragged through the mud. His honor, his dignity, his plan, his principle will not be dragged through the mud. And I don't know what that answer is, but if we're going to stand and proclaim that or we're going to sit and say nothing, where do we see ourselves today? And then here comes the next part. Well, Dennis, you don't understand. Okay. And I will accept that because no one knows exactly what you're going through. Only you do. And God. We try. Well, let's see if we can start the process, because what are some of the giants in life today? Fear. How many people are just scared to death? Paralyzed there because the Philistine oppression is causing fear in my life. Fear takes it to the point of depression. Do you realize today how out of control mental health is in America? Teenagers, young adults just coming unraveled. It's real. Anxiety? I saw the other day what caught my eye was called the Tebow chair. Did you ever see it? It's this thing in Austria where they've developed this chair. And I thought it was Tim Tebow. I don't know. I want to see what it is. And you basically sit in this chair and it just comes up all around you. And it has all this robotic technology. And man, it gives you the massage from your feet up to your neck. And you got heat and air, Bluetooth. I mean, and it does one of the, it's pretty amazing. And you know it's really expensive when they don't give you the price. They say, call the number for this amazing deal. But part of the commercial for the Tebow chair talks about why we have so much tension in our body. And they spoke a lot about anxiety. They spoke a lot about just fear and uncertainty of your daily routine. This is in the Tebow chair ad. And these people they're trying to sell this chair to, friends, aren't homeless. These are people who are driving, you name the car, and it's probably, you know, in the bidding probably starts at $100,000 and up for these cars. The homes are in the millions that they're trying to target this audience for. And you mean those people have anxiety? Those people have fear. Those people will be much better when they get this full body massage in the Tebow chair to release all these things. Friends, these are pretty big giants. About financial issues. Who would think we'd be paying what we're paying for gasoline now? Who would think you're going to the store and decide, am I going to be able to buy this? Or am I going to have to put gas in? Or can I go? What can I do? I stood behind a guy last night in Dollar General. He had bought a pack of hot dogs, barbecue chips, and then everything else in his buggy was for his cat. 24-pound bag of cat food, all these little cans, all this, and the cat was going to eat just fine. And I'm standing there, you know how you profile someone when you're behind them? I profiled his home. And he was doing everything he could to feed his cat, and his meal was barbecue chips and hot dogs. people having issues with money? You bet they are. Doubts of faith. Oh, I believe it's evil. Well, I don't know. And you fill in the blank. Are there giants in the world today? You bet there are. That 9-foot Goliath guy, yeah. But I'm going to tell you what, these things are probably more intimidating and just as real as any Goliath you'll ever face. What do we do? For the past few weeks, you remember we've been looking at this whole concept of what it means to believe. And what belief produces and what it does in our life in the midst, can we say today, of the giants. You don't have to say it out loud, but what other giant have you inserted in there, or maybe more giants that are looking you square in the face and saying basically this? You know what they're saying? Your God is nothing. Isn't that what Goliath was saying? King Saul and your army, your God is nothing. And today, when we allow these things to cause us to stand there paralyzed in fear, unable to move or do anything, guess what? We're allowing it to say to us that our God, Jehovah, Yahweh, Elohim, is nothing. And His Son, Jesus, who came and died on the cross for our sin and rose triumphantly, defeated sin and death, it's nothing because I'm bowing to this instead of Him. Think about that. What are you bowing to today? There, the army of God were on their knees perplexed, not knowing what to do. Instead of bowing before God and asking for His intervention and His place and His purpose in their lives. Do you believe that God is able? God is able. Do you believe this? That trials test our faith. And trials not only test our faith, but what else do? They develop patience and perseverance. What did I leave out of that scripture? A three-letter word I left out. My brother, in James chapter 1, verse 2, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. Let the patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. You mean I got to? Yeah. Because God wants to do something through you and with this process if you'll see His glory and honor in the midst of this. What did David go on to do? Still deliver pizza? No. He may have. I don't know. Went on to be king. Was he perfect? No. But I want to believe in that process of shaping and molding. David learned many things that day. Will I stand or will I sit? Will I go forth or will I cower in the corner? Consider it joy when you fall into these trials, knowing the testing of your faith. It produces patience and perseverance. What's God trying to show me? Today we remember those who faced giants and made the supreme sacrifice for our nation. How many people around the world said, this whole thing is a farce? You call yourself a Christian, you call yourself this, you call yourself that, there's not a chance. We wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for the valiant men and women who made that supreme sacrifice, who were willing to lay their lives on the line. And today, according to the Census Bureau, over 1 million-plus soldiers, men and women, that they know of. And may we say countless others in nations around the world who worked for us that we don't count. for the purpose of victory. Do we have much to be grateful for? You bet, because these men and women did what? Their purpose was to not only protect liberty, it was to proclaim liberty. Think about it. The message just doesn't stop in one facet, but it's also a message of proclamation for everyone to know. Think of how many times, even with Daniel, as he was thrown into the lion's den, what happened after that? Hey, the God of Daniel now is going to be proclaimed and celebrated by all. And today, as we remember valiant men and women who faced giants, they not only protected, defended freedom, but they proclaimed it for all. It wasn't exclusive, and friends, today the message from Jesus is not just exclusive to a certain group of people, but it's to everybody. The message is simply, look, the giants that you're facing in life, they can come down as quickly as Goliath because of the faith exhibited by this young boy David. Take what God's giving you, use it, and watch what he'll do to bring victory in your life. Isn't that true as well of our country today? What caused us to be where we are? Valiant men and women, a Judeo foundation, a Judeo-Christian foundation. And isn't it sad that we see in so many ways we're willing to throw it away? You see, that's what drove David to say, no! You can't do what you're doing. You can't say what you're saying about my God who protects, who defends, who upholds, who empowers, who enables. You can't do that. And I'm not just going to say it, but I'm going to stand here and defend and proclaim that message. And I don't care who comes against me. We have communities, we have schools, we have families. We have America, we have the world who's asking the church, are you going to stand up and be valiant and proclaim that message to see those giants of opposition come down? And to know that our God is greater, our God is mightier, our God can do things beyond our wildest imagination, but he's asking you and me today to stand. And friends, I want to believe that we can be inspired by men and women who've given that supreme sacrifice for what they believe to be true. That you and I today can make that influence again in our homes, in our schools, in our jobs, our communities, the church, Bible school, you name it. God's asking us, are you going to bow to the giant or are you going to bow to me? And today we're reminded of men and women who said, no, we're going to stand for what we believe is true. So my message for you and for me today simply is this. Am I believing and am I understanding in the midst of this battle? Because friends, the battle is raging. There is a spiritual warfare ongoing. We battle in this realm of against the prince of the air. But do we believe today that greater is he that is in me than he who is in the world? The giants that you've caused and you've identified, are you bowing? Or are you standing for the kingdom of God to be exalted through your life? God's blessed us in so many ways, and we have so many opportunities before us according to his word. I pray the spirit and faith of David would inspire you. I pray the spirit and faith of men and women who gave of their lives for this great land would encourage you as well to stand and proclaim the message of Jesus and his love. Father, we love you and we praise you for Jesus. Help us now, Father, to know that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Help us now, Lord, to be grateful for what you've given us and who we are here in this great country. Help us now, Lord, to know that that giant, no matter how tall or how powerful we think it might be, help us now to know that it has no power over us. And may, Lord, that story of David cause us to stand up and proclaim your honor and your glory. I pray for victory in each life today. I pray that no longer we'll be silent, but we'll stand in all that we say and all that we do
to declare the message of Jesus and His love. Thank you for loving us and blessing us with this privilege to be here and to go forth into this world to share the message of Jesus and His love. As we ask and pray this in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Service today. We'd like to hear from you. Check out our website at SwissHillParkPMChurch.com for information on how to get in touch with us. God bless you.